Welcome everybody to this tutorial. Today I'm just gonna go ahead and enter Red Hat. We're not gonna do any more installations or anything of a kind. Today we're jumping in, but we're easing it in slowly. First I'm gonna show you the graphical user interface, and then we will move on to the terminal. I first want to show you where is what approximately. Before I do all of that, I have made some alterations to the Red Hat virtual machine. I have just assigned it more resources, and you can do the same by clicking on the settings and then going to system, and you have the motherboard, processor, acceleration. And these things you can only change while the machine is down. So once you power the machine up, these changes can no longer take effect. You see, I cannot do anything here. I need to turn the machine off, then make these changes. But in any case, you can see that I have assigned it almost 3 gigs of RAM, and I have assigned it an extra a CPU core. Hopefully, it's going to run a bit faster, and this is going to be a lot smoother experience. You can do the same if you wish, but it's not required. I'm simply doing this to save on time. It is not a pre-requirement of what we are about to do. Anyway, I'm just gonna go ahead and cancel that, minimize this, and have a look at this desktop. If some of you have used Mac, it's fairly similar to it. On the upper bar you have sound, network manager, power management, date, username, or you can put in your real name there if you wish. And on the left side over here, you have applications and places. So let's click on places. Okay, captured. Click on places. So it can take you home, documents, downloads, music, pictures, videos, pretty much similar as in Windows. You can even browse the network if you want, but doesn't really, we're not going to do that for now. Anyway, once you go into applications, for all of you Windows users out there, this is basically like the start menu. You just click on it, and then you have pretty much everything that you want here. You have the Firefox, we have the browser, which is the default one is Firefox, of course. And we're going to see, don't open it, my good man. Never mind, let's just, while it's opening it up for the first time, it's probably going to want to do some updates or something of a kind. Speaking of which, we need to do them as well, but first, let me just introduce you. So you have the Firefox browser here, you have the mail client, basically this is for music. For photos, you have LibreOffice, which is the equivalent of Microsoft Office. You can pretty much do anything in LibreOffice that you can do in Microsoft Office as well. So no problems there. And under files, if you're wondering what this is actually a file manager. So let's just go ahead and click on it to see what comes up. Excellent. So this is our file manager, and let's just kill this red gigantic thing in the background. Close them. Most of our time we will be spending at the command line, and we will be mostly dealing with the terminal. But it's good to know, it's good to have a look at these things, and it's good to actually be at least acquainted with the graphical user interface, if nothing else, as it is a prerequisite for using it as a desktop machine, but not a prerequisite as using for servers or anything of a kind, which we eventually want to be able to manage, control, install, and so on and so forth. Anyway, this is your file browser, and you can pretty much go anywhere from here. If I go down to computer, it's going to take me to where some of the system files are. I cannot access where the system files are. I cannot access some of them. You see there's an X here on root. If I double click on it, it says the location could not be displayed. You do not have the necessary permissions to view the contents of root. This is going to be a similar case in all, pretty much the same case actually, in all Linux distributions. You will not be able to access certain parts of it or see it unless you have a root password, or unless you are using a terminal to actually view it, which is very nice, primarily because it disables 99% of viruses out there, pretty much, because they cannot do anything on your system without proper permissions. So anyway, you have the temporary files, you have the root files, and here under var you have the log files somewhere just have a look at them. I'm generally not used to doing this via graphical user interface, but let's just have a look at it. So log, excellent. So you have these log files that you can later on read. Don't worry about it. We will go through them. We will read them. I will explain to you this in greater, in far, far, far greater detail. For now, I'm just introducing you to the graphical user interface, nothing else. So just go ahead and close this and go back to applications. And now you have categories of applications. So you have favorites. And these really are pretty much the most used applications in pretty much any Linux distro, terminal and Firefox and browser. They are the first two, and then comes the rest. So under accessories, I don't know, you have some stupid things that you would use for your daily affairs. Oh, by the way, the equivalent of Notepad in Linux, I would definitely say that it's gedit. Except it has like a ton load of more capabilities and options. There we go, definitely. But we're not, we can use it a little bit later on, but we'll mainly be using text editors in the terminal. So you can just go ahead and close that. If we go further down below, okay, so documentation, graphics, nothing there. Oh, come on, internet. Okay, so nothing there. Eh, excellent. Under Office. So here you have like LibreOffice Writer, which is Word, or LibreOffice Impress. I think that's the one for presentations in the Office package. I'm pretty sure that you know to which I am referring to. A PowerPoint. Tip of my tongue, but couldn't really remember. So LibreOffice Impress is basically PowerPoint, if I'm not mistaken. LibreOffice Draw, I think it's an equivalent of Paint or something of a kind, and LibreOffice Calc, which is basically Excel. If we go down further below, we got sound, video. Okay, so Cheese is for your webcam, just so you know. You can utilize your webcam with Cheese. Barresso is for burning CDs, but we can do all of these. You can burn CDs through via the terminal as well without any sort of problems. If we go down below, Sundry. Okay, so we got SELinux Troubleshooter. Print settings, not that important. Firewall, excellent. So you have the graphical user interface for the firewall. And if we go ahead and click on it, we're going to be prompted with a root password that's going to, oops, actually no, are you serious? And if I select this, oh no, okay, there will be a root password. That would be hilarious if there wasn't anything here. I would see if it didn't prompt me for a root password, then I could do pretty much whatever I wanted to the firewall. I would disavow. I would completely disavow Red Hat completely and utterly. Anyway, here you can, but fortunately, it does require the password. Here you can pretty much do anything with the firewall, and firewall in Linux is open source. Its capabilities are practically infinite. You can do whatever you want with it. There is pretty much nothing that you would need that you cannot do with a Linux firewall. It's amazing. I don't know, I'm sure you can find something and make me eat my own words, but you get the general idea. So you can decide what services do you want to allow, what ports, you got port forwarding, ICMP filter, this is for pinging, and so on and so forth. But look, all of this we will do later via the terminal, as that is the proper way of doing this, because on a server you don't have a graphical user interface and you have to do with what you have, primarily because graphical user interfaces are resource expensive and they waste RAM, they waste CPU, and you don't want them, plus all the power rests in the terminal, the almighty terminal. Anyway, so go back to applications, Sundry. We were here. SELinux is your, how shall I put this, is your, let's say, antivirus system, or a way of tightening down security eternally. We will deal with that later on, as it will present, as it will play a major role in this course. If you go down to system tools, you got settings, boxes, and a lot of things here, but I'm going to continue talking about that in the follow-up tutorial, as I am running a bit of short on time here, and there are a few things to which I wish to introduce you here as well, just so you know that you can access them this way as well, and more often than not, on a desktop, you will need to as well. Until then, I bid you farewell.